with confidence in the authority and sufficiency of the Word of God. Here's the Emmanuel Pulpit and Pastor Mike Stone.
One of my favorite stories to tell is of the young preacher who graduated from seminary, took his first church, and was preparing to preach his very first sermon as a pastor, but he didn't know what he should preach about. So he decided he would preach about the things he'd heard preached about when he was growing up in church as a young boy. And so he took for his text Proverbs 20, verse 1, and he preached against the evils of beveraged alcohol. For in Proverbs 20, verse 1, the Bible still says, by the way, that wine is a mocker, strong drink is a brawler, and whoever is deceived thereby is not wise. In the lobby after the sermon, there was a white-haired deacon waiting on him. Preacher, you wouldn't have any way of knowing this being new to town, but this is Budweiser country. In fact, the local Bud distributorship is the largest employer in the whole county. If I were you, I wouldn't preach anymore against alcohol. The young preacher got up the second Sunday, didn't know what to preach about, so he decided he'd preach about the stuff he'd heard preached about growing up as a boy. And so he preached that Sunday against the evil of cigarette smoking, taking for his text 1 Corinthians 6, where the Bible says that our bodies are the temple of the Holy Spirit, and we should glorify God with our bodies because we've been bought with a price. And wouldn't you know, that same white-haired deacon was waiting on in the lobby. Preacher, you wouldn't know this being new to town, but not only is this Budweiser country, this is Philip Morris country. In fact, most of the church budget is supported through the sale of longleaf tobacco at the Big Z Tobacco Warehouse. I wouldn't preach anymore against drinking. I wouldn't preach anymore against smoking. Well, the preacher got up the third Sunday, didn't know what to preach about, so he decided he'd preach about the stuff he'd heard preached about when he was growing up in church as a boy, and he decided to preach against the wickedness of playing the Georgia lottery. I said he decided to preach against the wickedness of playing the Georgia lottery, taking for his text 1 Timothy chapter 6, that the love of money is the root of all kinds of evil, and many by pursuing it have pierced themselves through with many a scratch-off ticket. I mean, with many a pain. And wouldn't you know it, that white-haired deacon was waiting on him out in the lobby. Preacher, I know you have no way to know this, but not only is this alcohol country and tobacco country, but just across the state line, there's a greyhound dog track. Half your Christmas bonus comes from money that the deacons win on Saturday nights betting on the dogs. I wouldn't preach anymore against gambling if I were you. So the young preacher got up that fourth Sunday of his pastorate, and he said, I preached against drinking and smoking and gambling. I've been told that all of y'all are doing that, so I don't know what to preach against. And so the treasurer jumped to his feet, and he said, preach against tithing, brother. Ain't none of them here doing that. Well, in all seriousness, if I were to preach today against going to Sunday school, would you be convicted? If I were to preach against getting yourself and your family in small group Bible study at the church you call your church home, if for some strange, mysterious, inexplicable reason I preached against that, would there be any consternation of spirit or conviction of soul in your seat? Today, there are other sermons I would like to present as a preacher. But as a pastor, I believe we need to be better organized, more fully and effectively organized to fulfill the Great Commission as a church through the ministry we call Sunday school. Now, if you come from a different church or a different background, you may call it small group Bible study. You may call it life group, Bible fellowship, connection groups. Whatever you call it, we still call it Sunday school. And I submit today we need to get back to Sunday school. Now, our Sunday school ministry is dealing with the challenges that all churches have faced over the last 2 years. And that challenge has been prompted by the global pandemic we call COVID-19. And much of our church has begun to recover. The choir ministry is recovering. The student ministry recovering. Much of our church is already in the aftermath of the global pandemic. But Sunday school, quite honestly, is still lagging behind in recovery. And I have to be honest, I understand why that is so. 2 years ago at this time, we didn't understand all of the ramifications of this worldwide pandemic. And one of the things that we knew we did not need to do was get together up close, personal, face to face in a small little room with a bunch of people and then disperse out through the community. And so even after we began regathering in corporate worship, we continued to wait in regathering in Sunday school. And there were legitimate reasons for postponing regathering for Sunday school. And as we have navigated the last 24 months and what is now basically the aftermath of this global pandemic, Sunday school continues to lag behind in its recovery. Now, I think we need to be honest with one another at the outset of this message. COVID-19 is essentially over insofar as it being a fearful global pandemic. I did not say that COVID-19 isn't still real and that people are not still diagnosed with it, suffering with it, or even dying with it, if not from it. My own father, greatest man I know in the world, is still suffering today, recovering from a fairly recent double whammy of COVID-19 and double pneumonia. So I do not take lightly the reality that COVID-19 is a very real disease. But what I mean is that if we're honest, and you don't want to be dishonest at church, what I mean is, with the rarest of exceptions, we go where we want to go.
You're right. Come on.
And we do pretty much whatever we want to do. Stated another way, don't tell me you're afraid of going to Sunday school because of COVID when we're at a buffet or standing in Lowe's or Walmart. We generally go where we want to go and do what we want to do. With that being said, one of the places I submit we need to go is back to Sunday school.
Amen.
To get back to basics, back to fundamentals, back to business, and back to Sunday school. Now, back to Sunday school is the name of a Sunday school emphasis we've been working on at the staff and leadership level literally for months. And we've been sharing this with your Sunday school teachers and our Sunday school organizational leadership for the last several weeks. It is effective, it is going into effect on Easter Sunday, April the 17th. And specifically, my challenge to you is this, that starting on Easter Sunday, April the 17th, and continuing through May the 15th, I challenge you to attend at least 3 of those 5 Sundays. Now, if you do the math, that's 60%. Your math teacher won't accept 60%. But we're challenging you to begin attending at least 3 out of those 5 Sundays. Now, in any crowd of this size, there's at least one religious person, at least one Pharisee that wants to say, "Pastor, I believe we should challenge to 5 out of 5. Hallelujah." Well, you ain't coming 3 out of 5 now. For most members of our congregation, making a commitment to at least 3 out of 5 would be an increased commitment to Sunday school. And if you think it ought to be 4 out of 5 or 5 out of 5, I agree with you. But 5 out of 5 is at least 3 out of 5. I think we need to get back to Sunday school. Now, if you are a newer member or attender of our congregation, you may not know, but for most of the last 30 years, our church has organized our Great Commission efforts through the ministry of the Sunday school. And you may ask, why have we historically focused so much on Sunday school? It's because we believe that's the best tool we have at our availability to fulfill the Great Commission. And so on many occasions, I've shared this quote with this church, that Sunday school is not an organization of the church. Sunday school is the church organized to fulfill the Great Commission. If we are to be anything at all, we should be a Jesus-exalting, Bible-teaching, Great Commission church. And if we don't do those things, it really doesn't matter what else we do well. It doesn't matter if the choir brings us to our feet. It doesn't matter if the teaching brings us to an amen. It doesn't matter if our best friends are here, if our kids enjoy the programming, if our youth enjoy all of the activities. If we are not a Christ-exalting, Bible-teaching, Great Commission church, nothing else we do will ultimately matter a hill of beans. The Great Commission is given to us in each of the four Gospels and earlier in this very book of Acts. Matthew 28, beginning in the 19th verse, Jesus said, "Go therefore and make disciples of all the nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, and teaching them to observe all things whatsoever I commanded you, and lo, I am with you always, even to the end of the age. Amen." Mark's rendering of the Great Commission is easier to memorize, but just as hard to put into practice. "Go into all the world and preach the gospel to every creature." In Luke chapter 24, Jesus proclaimed that repentance for the forgiveness of sin would be proclaimed in his name to all the nations, beginning from Jerusalem. You are witnesses of these things. John's giving of it is rather succinct. "As the Father has sent me," Jesus said, "so send I you." And recently our memory work was drawn from Acts 1, verse 8. Jesus declared, "But you shall receive power when the Holy Spirit has come upon you, and you shall be witnesses to me in Jerusalem and in all Judea and Samaria and to the end of the earth." Now, when we make our way up to Acts 2, verses 41 and 42, this is a marked up passage in your Bible. If you're one of those note takers who write down names and dates and sermon titles in the margin of your Bible, because this section of Scripture is vital to the ministry of the church. It is as integral to my ministry as a constitutional lawyer quoting from the First Amendment. It is as vitally a part of my ministry as a hammer is to a contractor or a pipe wrench is to a plumber. What we have here in the text is the infancy of the church. The church in its newest, best, and purest form. And while this text is not about Sunday school as a ministry, it is a description of the church. And I want to take just a few precious moments today and show you how our Sunday school ministry and your commitment to get back to it can help our congregation have the same ministry impact that the early New Testament church had. First of all, I think we need to get back to Sunday school. That is, you individually and us as a church, we need to get back because of an increased emphasis on evangelism. Now, there are a lot of reasons why I believe in the ministry of the Sunday school. I believe in it as a Christian. I grew up in a home that went to church and Sunday school. We went back to what then was called training union on Sunday night and stayed for the evening service. For most of my boyhood, we went to midweek on Thursday night, but when we went to a church that had midweek on Wednesday night, we went to that too. Sunday school was a vital part of my upbringing as a child. In fact, for those of you that work in the preschool, children, and youth department, for those of you that teach in the single adult department, I'm convinced you'll teach with greater passion, faithfulness, and fervency. If you'll realize you don't just have students in front of you, you have some future moms and dads in front of you. You have some future deacons sitting in front of you. You've got some future student ministers and missionaries. And maybe the next pastor of this church may be sitting in your Sunday school class every time that you gather. I believe in the ministry of Sunday school as a Christian. I believe in the ministry of Sunday school as a member of this church. Longtime members of Emmanuel know that it is the ministry of the Sunday school that God has so powerfully used in the life of this church for decades in the past. I believe in Sunday school as a discipler, as one that is called to pour the word of God into others. I believe in Sunday school as a pastor. I contend it is the best way for us to provide ministry and pastoral care for the hundreds of people that call Emmanuel Baptist their church home. But I want to take just a moment and share with you a few reasons why I believe in Sunday school as an evangelist. For the Bible says to the ministry of the pastor in 2 Timothy chapter 4 that I am to do the work of an evangelist. And so are you. For we are each and every one called to be on mission to be witnesses for Christ. And there are a lot of different tools at our disposal. A gospel tract, a marked Bible, a color witness bracelet, and the ministry of the Sunday school. How can Sunday school bring us an increased emphasis on evangelism? Well, first, by birthing disciples. Now, if your Bible is still open, I'm just going to move through the text. I hope your Bible or your Bible app is open. Look down at verse 41. So then those who had received his word. Nothing will bring about passion, zeal, and red-hot Holy Ghost revival like us sharing our faith and seeing lost people gloriously born again. And I don't care what vehicle or tool you may use, that won't happen without a proclamation of the Word of God. The only ones that were baptized are those that were saved. I could stop and preach there for a moment. I said the only ones that were baptized are those that were already saved. And none of them got saved until they had received the word that was preached. Paul said that this kind of faith, I'm talking about the faith some of you need to receive from the Lord today. Sin forgiving, soul cleansing, eternity transforming faith. Faith cometh by hearing, and hearing the word of God. It is through the ministry of the Sunday school that the word of God is taught and lost people can be saved. For you see, Sunday school is the only ministry of the church that anybody and everybody connected with our church at all can immediately get plugged into. Student ministry is for youth. Children's ministry is for children. The deacon ministry is for God-called, God-qualified men. The music ministry, hopefully, is for those who have some modicum of musical talent. Otherwise, Brother Andrew will ask you to go sing on a hill far away. Or to perhaps go sing in the garden alone. Men's ministry is for men. Women's ministry is for the women. But the Sunday school ministry is for anyone and everyone. The young and the old. The married and the single, the church member and the guest. Listen, the saved and the lost. And it just stands to reason, if we've got a ministry into which a lot of lost people can be placed and the word of God is being faithfully preached, I'll tell you what will happen. The same thing that happened for me when my boyhood preacher faithfully preached the word of God in the Sunday night service. I was, as the old hymn writer said, I was born of the Spirit with life from above into God's family divine. Sunday school can be a ministry that involves birthing disciples. That is why, and I want to say this as lovingly and graciously as I can, it is irreconcilable. That means that dog won't hunt. That means don't waste your breath or my time telling me that you are so mature in the faith that you're not involved in or concerned about the evangelistic ministry of the church. Nobody is such a deep water disciple that you don't care about seeing lost people saved. If you think you've gone so deep in the word that you don't care about going out with the word, you ain't gone near as deep in the word as you think you've gone. You concerned about the things of God, then you ought to be concerned about being involved in faithful attendance in the evangelistic arm of the church. Getting back to Sunday school will bring an increased emphasis on evangelism by birthing disciples. Secondly, by baptizing disciples. I'm back in verse 41. So then those who had received his word were baptized. Now, I've already told you I've got to discipline myself to not preach a sermon on believers' baptism, but I will tell you this, the word of God knows nothing. Would you say the word nothing? I didn't say difference of opinion or variance of interpretation. The word of God knows absolutely nothing of a born-again believer that will not follow the Lord Jesus Christ by being immersed in water as an outward sign of an inward change, picturing the death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus Christ. And without seeking to offend anybody else, there's no waiting period. There's no testing period. All it took was a profession of faith. Jesus is my Lord. And they were baptized into the body of Christ. Now Sunday school can help us baptize believers. Few ministries in the Lord's church have a more direct impact on the baptizing of new converts than the ministry of the Sunday school. In fact, in the 25 years I've been on your church staff, nearly 20 of those as your pastor, I could show you statistically, I mean that literally, I could show you charts and graphs where the number of baptisms we saw that year are almost identical to the number of people we had at Monday night visitation. Organize outreach into the community. And the fastest way to see more people saved and baptized is the creation of new units, the birthing of new Sunday school classes that now are new outreach vehicles to take the gospel out into our community. Dr. Ken Hemphill, former president of the Southwestern Baptist Theological Seminary, wrote a classic book on Sunday school called Revitalizing the Sunday Morning Dinosaur. And in that book, he writes, after a person has made a personal commitment to Christ, he or she must then be baptized into the life of a local congregation. He writes, I often translate the word baptism as assimilation. New believers must be incorporated into the life of a New Testament church. I love this. Evangelistic concern that does not focus on congregationalizing the convert is not New Testament evangelism. Listen carefully as I talk about evangelism and an increased emphasis upon it. The last thing I have in my mind is a bunch of heads bowed, eyes closed, nobody's looking around, whisper a recited prayer, raise your hand, and we're going to pronounce that you've come to faith in Christ, only to see that person never grow up in the Lord, never get involved in the life of the church. That may be something, but it ain't New Testament evangelism. Whenever we focus on evangelism, someone might say, Brother Mike, you talk like seeing somebody saved is the end of the Great Commission. It is the end of the Great Commission. It's the front end. It's the start. We see in Acts 2:41, they are busy in evangelism, birthing disciples, baptizing disciples, but then thirdly, building disciples. For the end of verse 41, you're looking at it, I know, in your Bible says, and that day there were added about 3,000 souls. Years ago, the Oxygen Network on cable television came under criticism for promoting a documentary about a rap artist from Atlanta who had 11 children by 10 different women. And all 22 of them lived under the same roof, these 11 kids, the 10 women, and the gigolo. And the name of the show was My Babies, plural, My Babies, Mamas. I cite that old documentary to say that there are a lot of people who treat evangelism like that. Birth them and leave them. That is not New Testament evangelism. They were organized to begin pouring the Word of God into the hearts and lives of these new converts. Now, whenever we talk about organizing to do ministry, there'll always be someone who says, well, I don't really believe in organized religion. Well, what do you believe in then? Disorganized religion? What they were doing here was not haphazard. It was systematic. It was intentional. It was planned. And no doubt in any group of this size, whenever you begin to talk about baptism and numbers, someone will say, are you just concerned about numbers? Well, I'm not just concerned about numbers, but I am concerned about numbers. In fact, we have 4 children, and I want you to imagine that you have 4 children, and imagine they're the same age and gender of my 4 children. So we're going to go over to Valdosta to Wild Adventures for the day, and I say each of my kids can bring one of their friends. And so my 4 kids, we bring all 4 of your kids as well. But when we come back home, we only bring 3 of them back. That's 75%. You can graduate from college with 75%. You concerned about numbers now? Some of you are wanting to say, well, which one did you leave? Numbers represent souls. And if you believe, as this church believes, in the verbal inspiration of Scripture, then we know it is not accidental, it is providential, that the text says there were added to them 3,000 souls. Not 3,000 names, not 3,000 notches in an evangelistic belt, not 3,000 cards, not 3,000 tithing envelopes, 3,000 souls. And the text will tell us in the next verse, they begin continually gathering together, no doubt in an organized fashion, because the Bible says in 1 Corinthians that God is not the author of confusion. He calls there to be order in the church. Now, whenever we emphasize numbers, someone will always criticize. So let me give you a number I think you can easily wrap your mind around, because part of our Back to Sunday School emphasis, April 17 through May the 15th, includes High Attendance Day, the Sunday after Easter. High Attendance Day will be April the 24th, and our goal that day is one. Sound like we're boasting about numbers? The goal is one. By that, I mean everyone. The goal is you. That every one of you get everyone in your family and everyone under your influence to invite every one of your neighbors, every one of your classmates, every one of your teammates, and we commit ourselves that on that one day, every one of us and every one that we can invite and influence and bring, that everyone is in Bible study. Now, if Emmanuel Baptist Church is going to evangelize the lost and disciple the saved, it can occur through the Sunday school. Now, one thing about preaching about Sunday school, and I've got a lot of experience in doing this, it brings church growth experts out of the woodwork. And so I simply want to tell you that any other ministry that you think Sunday school doesn't work anymore, we've got to do this, we need to focus on that. If you'll listen to yourself talk, everything you're describing can be done through the ministry of a Sunday school class. I think we need to get back to Sunday school in part because it will bring about an increased emphasis on evangelism. Secondly, it will bring about an intentional emphasis on education. Do you notice what we call this ministry? It's called Sunday. Now, kids, you may want to put your fingers in your ear for just a moment. We call it Sunday school. Not Sunday coffee. Not Sunday social hour. Not Sunday fellowship. Not Sunday football talk. Now, I think in a healthy Sunday school class, all those things that I've just described, each and every one of them can be a part. Fellowship together, socialize, share some things that happened that weekend, what's going on in the kids' lives, and if you can do that over a cup of coffee, I say hallelujah to the Lamb of God. But it's called Sunday school because it has an emphasis on education. The text says in verse 42, they were continually devoting themselves to the apostles' teaching. One translation says, to the apostles' doctrine. Now, we are to emphasize biblical education through the ministries of our church. We do not exist merely to clap and sing and shout. We don't exist merely to give and send out missionaries if we've not established what is it that we're singing about. Who is it that we're clapping for? What message are the sent missionaries going to go and proclaim? We must do what our scripture verse said a few months ago. We must be diligent to present ourselves approved to God, a worker. That doesn't sound easy, does it, church? A worker who does not need to be ashamed, rightly dividing the word of truth. Sunday school and our emphasis upon it will bring about an intentional emphasis on education. There are three aspects of this in the first half of verse 42. Notice there is spiritual devotion. They were continually devoting themselves. Now I repeat myself intentionally for emphasis. This is not the story of people who had merely bowed their head, closed their eyes, whispered a prayer, walked an aisle, filled out a card, and gone through the baptismal waters. No, this is the biblical narrative and record of those who stayed with the stuff, who continually devoted themselves in spiritual devotion. And by the way, it is a vital and necessary part of the human heart that you are devoted to something. You're devoted to something. You're committed to someone. Sometimes we're too devoted to ourselves, too committed to ourselves, but you're committed to something. There's something that's more important to you than anything else. There's someone that's more important to you than anyone else. And when they have a need, you'll drop anything going on with anybody else because of the one to whom you are most devoted. That's just characteristic and inevitable part of our own human nature. We're devoted and committed to something. It has been frequently said that when it comes to commitment, many believers will stop at nothing. Chew on that. I've lived just over 51 years. More than half of that has been on your church staff. And I've seen a lot in my time. And I've discovered one truth that is absolutely true of all people. It is absolutely true that we generally do what we want to do. There may be some exceptions because of health, providential hindrings, or perhaps financial encumbrance. But I think if most of us are honest, we generally do what we want to do. Hebrews 10, 24 and 25 says that we should consider how to stimulate one another to love and to good deeds, not forsaking the assembling of ourselves together, as is the manner of some, but encouraging one another, and so much the more as you see the day approaching. I'm talking about spiritual devotion. Now, the early bird service, they had an advantage that you didn't have. That is, I preached this sermon to them, and then 15 minutes later, they had a chance to go to Sunday school. You got to wait a whole nother week. But I want you to imagine a question with me and see if this prayer makes sense to you. I'm talking to those that call Emmanuel Baptist their church home. If you're a guest of ours today, I encourage you to apply these principles to the church where you normally attend. But I'm talking to Emmanuel folks today. I want you to listen to this prayer. Lord, my pastor and my church staff, the spiritual leaders that you have given a position of authority in this congregation, where I say you've called me and my family to fulfill our kingdom work through this church. My pastor is up there today challenging the entire church to get back to Sunday school. That means that next week after, for this service, before I come to church, there's going to be a small group of believers gathering together in a room at my church studying the Word of God. All I've got to do is go 75 minutes earlier than I've been coming anyway. It's at my church. I'll already be dressed. I'll already be there. They're going to help me learn the Word of God, fellowship with other believers. They'll take prayer requests and pray for me. They'll be used by God to hold me accountable to grow in the grace and knowledge of the Scripture. Lord, I want to ask you, you think I ought to go? Now, you chuckle for two reasons. Number one, my voice inflection. I said it to be funny. That's an absurd question. You may as well, sir, ask God, does he want you to be faithful to your wife? Does he want you to be honest on the job? Does he want you to be kind and forgiving? As to say, Lord, do you want me to be a part of my church's commitment to reaching the lost, discipling the saved, and studying the Word of God together? Spiritual devotion. Secondly, we see a picture of steadfast discipline. Verse 42 continues, they were continually, one translation says, steadfastly devoting themselves to the apostles' teaching. The word steadfast means to be fixed in your place. It means that you can be counted on. It speaks of a constant, regular, I dare say, a daily commitment to discipline yourself. Now, I want you to look up to the screen. You may have read it. You may have written it down in your notes. Steadfast discipline. Look at that word discipline. I've regularly taught you that the word discipline and the word disciple are not even spelled differently until you get to the eighth letter. There's no such thing as an undisciplined disciple. That's a contradiction of terms. To be disciplined is to be a disciple. To be a disciple is to be marked by discipline. And you never have to discipline yourself to do stuff your flesh wants to do. I'm going to say that again. You don't have to discipline yourself to do stuff that your flesh naturally wants to do. Most of us don't have to discipline ourselves. I'm going to force myself to eat a candy bar. No, we have to discipline ourselves to not eat all the junk food. I'm going to discipline myself by staying in bed an extra hour and skipping Sunday school. I've been so bad this week, I don't deserve to go to Sunday school. You don't have to discipline yourself to do stuff that your flesh wants to do. You have to discipline yourself to do stuff that your spirit knows that you ought to do, but your flesh doesn't want to do. That when the spirit is willing, but the flesh is weak, we don't say, well, I'm going to follow my weak flesh. No, we have our spirit man tell our flesh what's going to happen. Steadfast discipline. When was the last time you devoted yourself to discipline? When was the last time you told your carnal, stinking, rotten flesh, no? That I know that's what you want to do, but God's word said something different and I'm not going to do it. Or I know that's not what you want to do, but God's word said to do it. I'm saying no to my flesh. I'm disciplining myself and I will do what God commands. I will shirk what God prohibits. That's good preaching, even in a Sunday school sermon. Steadfast discipline. There's spiritual devotion. Thirdly, we see here the emphasis on sound doctrine. Still in verse 42, and they were continually devoting themselves to the apostles' teaching. That word teaching is also rightly translated as doctrine. You teach something to yourself and your kids everywhere you go and everything that you do. We live in a world where doctrine is all around us. Don't ever believe that doctrine is a dirty word. Doctrine is a Bible word. Critics of doctrine will say doctrine divides. You're absolutely right, it divides. It divides truth from error. Fact from fiction. Your religious upbringing, your own personal religious philosophies, sound doctrine brings all that up under the authority and sufficiency of the Word of God and tells you you don't have the privilege as a blood-bought believer, you don't have the privilege to have an idea or a thought about God that cannot be supported by His Word. That's doctrine. We teach our children and we teach our neighbors everywhere we go and everything that we do. For example, if you sing in the car to the country station or the secular station all week long but shut your mouth in the house of God, you've just taught your family an awful lot. Doesn't mean that it's something good, but you taught them something. When you never miss a recital, when you never miss a practice, when you never miss a band rehearsal, when you never miss a volleyball tournament, when you never miss a tennis match, but you think nothing about laying out of church and laying out a small group Bible study, you've just taught your children a mouthful. But we don't need to be focused on teaching unsound doctrine. Sound doctrine. They devoted themselves to the apostles' doctrine. I heard about a Baptist man and a Methodist man that were working at the local railroad. And the Baptists and the Methodists, they were arguing about which one of them knew the Bible better. They were always sharing Bible stories at break. And the Baptist said to the Methodist, he said, "You don't know the Bible as well as you think you do. I bet you couldn't even quote the Lord's Prayer." And the Methodist said, "How much you want to bet?" The Baptist said, "I'll bet you $10 you can't quote the Lord's Prayer." And the Methodist squared his shoulders and said, "Now I lay me down to sleep. I pray the Lord my soul to keep. If I should die before I wake, I pray the Lord my soul to take." And the Baptist reached in his pocket, said, "Well, I didn't think you had it in you, but a bet's a bet. I'm a man of my word." That story, of course, is not true, but it represents something that is unfortunately all too commonly true. That is, many people who come to worship on a regular basis have just an absolutely mind-boggling ignorance of the Word of God. Because you're never going to learn the Word of God merely by coming and listening to me preach the Word of God 45 minutes each week. Any more than you're going to be physically well by going to a restaurant and watching someone else eat. You need to dig in it yourself. And far too many false religious groups and pseudo-Christian cults, their membership rolls are littered with former Southern Baptists who all they ever knew was hell's hot, heaven's sweet, and Jesus saves. There are plenty of cults that will teach you that. But it goes doctrinally downhill in a hurry after that. The only reason a lot of Southern Baptist church members don't belong to the Jehovah's False Witnesses is because they haven't built the newest gymnasium in town yet. Because they haven't hired the youth minister with the skinny jeans and the plaid shirt and the spiked hair in desperate need of a hairbrush. May God give us a ministry of sound doctrine. The Great Commission declares, teaching them to observe all things whatsoever I've commanded you. God knows that as a pastor and as a daddy, I need some other believers coming alongside me and alongside my children and reinforcing the truth of the Word of God through sound doctrine. Why do we need to get back to Sunday school? Well, there's an increased emphasis on evangelism. An intentional emphasis on education. Finally, and quickly, there's an internal emphasis on encouragement. The second half of verse 42 describes the encouraging ministry of the Sunday school. Three things real quickly. Notice the life they lived together. The life they lived together. The text says they devoted themselves to fellowship. The word here is koinonia. That means an awful lot more than hanging out together. It literally means partnering together, sharing life together. This is real ministry. You know, a lot of churches these days, they have a little motto, a moniker. You can see it on their websites and ball caps, t-shirts. Doing life together. The Fourth Baptist Church, doing life together. Clear Creek Bible Church, doing life together. Sardis Baptist Church, doing life together. That little phrase may be overused, but it ain't a bad one. Doing life together. The lives of these early believers, they were interwoven, interconnected, and intertwined. So much that when one of them had a hurt, everybody else in the group began to weep. And when one of them had a victory, the rest of the group began to celebrate and rejoice. Or as I like to say it, if one of them drank a Pepsi, the rest of the group might burp. They were living life together. And may I say as your pastor that a large church must minister in some way through small groups by necessity. Because if there's a need in your life, very often I may not even know about it. But in that small group of the Sunday school class, needs can be shared, needs can be met. There's the giving and the receiving of ministry through the Sunday school, the life they lived together. Notice also the Lord they loved together, for they devoted themselves to fellowship, to the breaking of bread. Now, many commentators believe this is in reference to the Lord's Supper. They are simply getting together for Bible study and for worship. Now, occasionally there are people who go to Sunday school but don't stay for worship, but that is a rare thing. Most people who do one or the other, they come to worship, but they don't go to Sunday school. There is no better way to grow the ministry of this worship service than to get people involved in small group Bible study that we call Sunday school. And nothing, but absolutely nothing, will enhance the worship that we share together than the sound doctrine we can learn in a Sunday school class. What is it that we're singing about God? Which God are we singing to? Which Lord are we singing about? When we sing about redemption and salvation and being purchased by His blood, what does that mean? Well, we learn that when we study the Word of God together. The life they lived together, the Lord they loved together. Note finally, the load they lifted together. And they devoted themselves to the apostles' doctrine, to fellowship, to the breaking of bread, and to prayer. Now, I want to ask you a real practical question. Do you think these 3,000 people sat around painstakingly taking prayer requests? Do you think after about 1,200 prayer requests that Simon Peter finally said, "Are there any unspoken?" and hands go up everywhere? No, they are obviously in small groups praying together, learning one another's needs and meeting one another's needs through some organized system. It was in 1949 that the late Dr. Billy Graham conducted a citywide revival in Los Angeles. God really moved in a powerful way. But an Episcopalian clergyman wrote a rather scathing op-ed for the Los Angeles paper, and he accused the North Carolina evangelist of setting Christianity back 200 years. To which, in his winsome southern drawl, Mr. Graham replied, "I'm sorry. I didn't mean to set it back 200 years. I meant to set it back 2,000 years. Back to the days of the New Testament, back to the days of the early church, and I want to set us back. Back to basics, back to fundamentals, back to business, back to Sunday school."
You've been listening to The Emmanuel Pulpit, the broadcast ministry of Pastor Mike Stone, Senior Pastor of Emmanuel Baptist Church in Blackshear, Georgia. With confidence in the authority and sufficiency of the Word of God, Pastor Mike is committed to walking you verse by verse through books of the Bible. We pray this message has been an encouragement to you as you seek to learn and live the Word of God. Free audio downloads of this message, as well as general contact information, are available through our website at ebchurch.net. Thanks for joining us for today's message from the Emmanuel Pulpit.